It's like they get paid just to limit you. You know what I believe? I believe that if you study hard and you work harder, that, well, the sky's the limits. You see, at Ball for Life, we believe anything's possible.
Oh, hey, yo, that was crazy. Did that, yo,
bro, I was like 10 feet, yo, son. So he was like 10 feet above the rim.
Yo.
Yo, what up, man?
Yo.
Salute, boy.
Yo, you go, turn your camera. Hey, yo, what's up, bro?
What's up, brother?
Yo, this is a blessing. You know, it's a blessing. It's an honor, B.
Hey, number one, man, let me, you don't mind if I drink on your live, right?
Hey, man, salute. We so grow.
I got a glass of wine. I want to salute to, if not one of the forefathers of this whole streetball and the movement and what inspired me. And if it wasn't for streetball, it wouldn't open up to all the avenues. So again, to somebody who I looked up to, a mentor, Waliyy, Dixon, Main Event.
I salute you, bro. Thank you, man. It's like, yo, before we start, I just want to give a quick 30 seconds, a moment of silence to one of our fellows we lost this week, Killer Kirby. So just a quick 30 seconds. Let's get a moment of silence. Thank you. Now, TRIXX, I gotta do you how I do everybody before we start. Sit tight. Give me a minute. For those that don't know, I just want to show them so. Yo, there's gonna be a reason why I had to get to that, you know. So I'm gonna come back to why I showed that. And just for those that don't know, who is Louis the Silver, aka TRIXX?
So first of all, my parents, my dad, you know, immigrant from Portugal, came in when he was 6 years old, grew up in Newark. He met my mom when she, you know, they were 16 years old, never graduated high school. You know, back in the 60s and 70s was a different day and age. It's just trying to make ends meet. They had a family at young age. My mom was 18, my dad was 19. They started a family, just, you know, struggling like most of us experienced growing up in Elizabeth, New Jersey, downtown on Ripley Place, so on between First and Second Street, Portuguese, Italian, the area, as you know, man, you're from Linden. Elizabeth was pretty rough growing up. My parents didn't really want me out in the basketball courts. It was a different day and age. This is even before pre-street ball, when everybody's really playing outdoors. So I was confined to a backyard that was 4x6, man. I had a little huffy basketball. And you, as you know, street ball, man, shooting was never my forte. So you can only imagine how many screen doors I was breaking. So all I could do was pretty much just sit there and just dribble. And I was like, you know what? I kind of utilized the space I had and just kept dribbling, and grew a passion for it. You know, I was went to St. Peter and Paul, graduated St. Patrick's in 2000. My parents, you know, worked very hard to try to keep me in private school, and was a good kid, man. I stood out of trouble and had a passion for basketball. Like everyone growing up, being in the NBA is the passion. But you know, in doing that on the weekends, my mom would walk around the park in what we call the pond, Wilson Park in Linden. So we take the drive from Elizabeth to Linden and walk around the park. And while we were doing that, my mom would let me go play basketball. And obviously, that's probably the first court I was introduced to other players that were maybe equally as good as me or even better. And then there was words around people that were the most successful at the time that made it out. You were like your name rang bells, but this is before people understand, you know, the late 90s, early 2000s, man, we didn't have social media. Everything was word of mouth, magazine. So people, like kids now, 2021, they can't even fathom that. What do you mean word of mouth? Like, you can't just hashtag a name or find a handle. We have to just know who it was. So, you know, everybody, if they didn't know you by face, they heard of your name, like myself. So, you know, I grew up, graduated high school. I played basketball in high school, but you got to think, man, during that I was a freshman in 97 when I went to St. Pat's, and Shaheen Holloway was an All-American graduate. So it was, you know, Kevin Boyle at the time, he had point guards already lined up. So he had the Circus, right? Jerome Holman.
Yeah, that's right, and they had
Jamal Jackson from Newark.
Yep.
They had Bernard Champion from Brooklyn, and they had, you know, Al Harrington, Sam Dallenberg. So he had a lineup from freshman year. So our JV team was an average varsity team, and our varsity team could probably beat some D2, D3 teams. And that's just how it was in that type of era. But my passion was, even though it was, you know, playing, and I think I played one freshman game. We played Science North Tech or something like that. My mom was at every game. You know my mom, man. She's at every event. We're very family oriented, and she knew I had the desire and passion for the culture and music. But, you know, it's unorthodox to be Portuguese and Italian at that time to not play soccer or baseball, but you want to play basketball. Like, I'm 6 feet at best, 100s, like basketball. That's not, you know, you don't do that. Why don't you just play soccer, something that we're more practical with? So to fast forward, make a long story short, you know, got a chance to play a little bit. But even playing, whether it was a varsity level or JV, man, my desire and passion was what I wanted to do, what I can explore my talents. Because back then, the whole thing that Kyrie's doing, I felt like we paved the way for that. Because back then, I would get benched for the too much dribbling and getting to the lane. That whole, you know, tween wasn't the motion. It was more of a, who was the player? Like a Brevin Knight. Very methodical, pass and go. So this was kind of, you guys were kind of revolutionizing the game, and the Racer Alston and the Booker Smiths and players that I never got to play with, but rewind the tape nonstop. So my passion and desire was like, man, I don't even care if I don't go to college to hoop, man. I want to play street ball. And man, it's just so many stories, so I could just keep going. So then,
that's incredible, because during all of those times, I've been watching you. Like, I never forget when it was me and my man Mutai. We was at St. Mark's Park, and you came to the back of the truck, and you was like, "Yo, man, event, what else? What up, Trixx?" He's like, "Yo, the best thing since Pat's okay." So I have been watching you. Have been hearing about you. That's going to take us to the next thing of what I was blessed to be able to do for you at the time. It was from me watching your work ethics.
Yeah,
like knowing that this is somebody I know I can reach out to that can get the job done.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We'll probably get into that, but that's from what you were saying earlier from, you know, I'm not going to go to college, but I know that Trixx was good at what he do.
Yeah, right.
And that's why I reached out to you.
And you know, it's funny you said that, because you always had, I mean, you had the business entrepreneur mind before it was kind of frowned upon. Like, nobody back then, before social media, there was entrepreneurs, but nothing in this capacity now where there's apps and new technology. You had the vision of, how do I place players and how can I monetize this? You've created, I give it to Shane and probably like a handful of others that you guys were kind of the forefathers of trying to, how do we monetize and protect it? Right? And how do we protect it? And I gotta commend you, man, because before social media, to have, and it's giving me chills now, to have the world, I mean, you inspired, I mean, let's make this clear, man. We would go out and you guys were the NBA. We were that streetball was more popular at that moment of time than NBA. It's something that nobody can even fathom. And to do that, to be on cell phone cases and anything you did, you had your image on commercials without social media. Sam, I tell people back, if this was 20 years ago, we would have like 8, 10, 15 million followers just because how you move the culture. So with that being said, you saw something that, and an ability that I had. And when I got the call one day, I was working, this is 1999, I was working in Woodbridge Mall, Athens Foot. And there's cool stories into that too, man. You know, you're young, Memphis Bleak used to come in there. I was running the front, so what do you do? You're 18 years old. I was giving Memphis Bleak free sneakers just for like an autograph, right? I didn't care, real shit. Like I was like, Memphis Bleak came through, I'm like, oh my God, the Rockefeller hat on Smash, man, he probably had, I still feel bad. Like it was so open, I just go back and like, man, I'd get a kid 8, 9, 10 free pieces of sneakers just for an autograph. Like you, this is something you grow up like, it doesn't matter to you. You're just so loose on love and not realizing, but you saw that I had the ability to dribble and watching me play. And then, you know, a close friend of mine, Davon Cousins, called and was like, yo, Main Event asked for you for this open call audition. And he was like,
they called me. Someone from Nike, sorry to cut you off, someone from Nike called me. They was like, your Main Event, we know you were A1, but your reputation in the streetball world, we want to know if you could get someone, they said five guys to come to an audition. And out of the five guys, they would guarantee me two guys. Yo, well, anything I love, I only called you.
Yo, it's crazy because Zeke was like, I don't know, but you need to call Maine. And I'm like, I'm sitting there nervous. I'm like, I heard about you, but I'm like, man, he wants to call me personal. I was like, this is big. Like, why is he wanting? So I remember we got on a quick conversation, but at that time, even though I was still in Linden and Elizabeth, you already took off. So you were barely home. You're traveling the world. You would come home for a week or two. We'll see you in the truck. And then you out. I mean, you were, you know, best thing since pants. But I mean, there's the first one who ever came out of Linden. I mean, literally. And even dating back to that, you know, your credibility in Linden High School, then Rutgers. I mean, you're just, you know, you're one of the best that ever did it at your height and jumping out of the gym. So he told me, he was like, you know, we got on the call, and I'll never forget this conversation because I remember my first day shooting this commercial was March 16th, 2001. It was at Kaufman Studios, but you said, yo, when you get to this open call audition that we're going, it was somewhere in New York, and Lance Jackson was in there, Speedy Williams, a couple of NBA players, but every legend was in there, Pee Wee, everybody, you name it, was in that building. And you said, I said, who do I sign in? You said, don't worry. Just tell him Rupert sent you.
Rupert, yep.
I'm going to tell you like this.
Rupert Samuel.
Till today, I've never met Rupert, yo, but I would love to just tell him, like, meet him and say hello. All I know is that name, but that got me through the door.
Wow.
I never met him. But till this day, I want to have this conversation. You just said, don't worry, Trixx, just say Rupert sent you. I walked to the lady that had a sign-in sheet. I said, Rupert sent me. Come right in here. Done. I was like, I don't know who Rupert is, but so we in this room in audition, man. I don't think you ever know the story. This is about me and my dad sitting there. Now I'm 18 years old, pants sweaty, palming in the motherfucker. They had a regular chair in an indoor gym and a cameraman. Mm-hmm. They call out a number. Next, they had a chair. You either dribble between the chair, try to do some moves, and they had the Jay-Z song playing. I think I forgot what song was. It was 1998. One of them. He had a million of them. But they just play the same Jay-Z track, and people just dribbling, call a number. Okay, thank you. Next number. And they ran around the whole gym. I was the last one to come in there. I'm sitting in there. I'm like, man, what are they going to call my number? So as people going, I even remember Speedy. They called his number. He's dabbing everybody, this, that, and the third. He left. I was the last one. So I started not to get that nervous because the gym was clearing out. Ah, man, I'm about to say, I don't know what to do, but I'm just going to do what I do in my backyard. They had the kid, they had the song playing. So before I dribbled, I was like, man, everybody dribbling. And I was like, that's everybody doing the same thing. So I was like, let me just do some tricks. So, man, I just started doing all my trick shit. I've been working on at the pond for years, Wilson Park. That whole song came. She said, play it again. Man, I started 6-7 minutes. Before you know the round, I'm doing this diamond cutter. I look around, the gym's packed again. Did you stop? You got, Pee Wee Kirkland, Speedy coming to my guy. Yo, what part of Harlem? You Spanish? I'm like, no, I'm from New Jersey. What? He's like, white kid from New Jersey. What the? Where is he from? You didn't play ball anywhere? We never seen you at the cage. I'm like, no. Like, who sent you here? Rupert. They were like, Rupert. I was like, well, Main Event. And they all looked at each other. Was like, yo. See, we started exchanging contacts. I left that day. me and my dad was like, man, it looks like everybody kind of liked it. My dad don't know basketball. You know what I'm saying? He was like, man, it looks like everybody kind of liked it. He gave me two. I went to work the next day. Literally the next day, phone rings. I'm at the front, Athlete's Foot, Woodbridge. Hello, Lewis speaking, Athlete's Foot, how can I help you? Yeah, can we speak to Lewis De Silva? Yeah, speaking. Yeah, well, he came to an audition. He came to an audition and such and such. Well, you got the role and we want to know if you're available for next Tuesday to come to Hoffman Studio. Hung up the phone. I thought that was Zeke or somebody fucking with me, right? So calls back. I think we misconnected. I was like, no. I knew this was legit. They were like, we got the audition. Can you take the day off? And I was like, hold on for a minute. I put it on hold. Bruce was the owner of the store at the time. White guy, Bruce, good dude. So I went in the back and I'm like, Bruce, you know, I need a day off next week or something. Oh, I don't know, Lewis, this, that, and the third. My gut said, Luke, just take the day off. I quit on the spot.
Wow, yo.
I quit on the spot. I was like, this is probably my chance. If Maine went out of his way to say, as Rupert, this could be something big, maybe I could get on. I was thinking, like, maybe it's the M1 tour, but they just trying to test me out. I didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, word is going, yo.
They had the car, my dad, they gave me the address. Me and my dad drove up to the studio, Hoffman Studio in Queens. And man, we shot that shit for 23 hours. Baron Davis, Shamika Holtzclaw,
A-Train,
Arnold Bernard, Chris Franklin, you name it was in that gym, yo. Raphael Edwards. Who's the other one? King of Brooklyn. Mike Campbell.
Mike Campbell.
He was in there. I mean, everybody. Corey Goodall.
And they
were just like, yo, Trix. Baron Davis is like, yo, get his kid the ball. Just keep going. So the director was Paul Hunter, who did all those dope rap videos. And then we had North own Savion Glover, who choreographed it. So he was like, we're going to do some tapping, but you with the beat. Once I got on, he was like, nah, just keep doing it. And I'm like, why they have me doing it all by myself? They were like, yo, Baron, pass it to him. Speedy, pass it to Lewis and pass it back. I'm like, I'm just doing this shit by myself. What the fuck they got in plan? But I'm just going with it. I'm dancing. I'm doing my shit.
So you freestyled the whole joint. Y'all didn't know what it was going to be like when it got done.
All that time. It wound up
being one of the best commercials that was ever done.
Here's the thing. That whole time, I'm like, why am I doing it by myself? They're like, just let him keep going. They already had a vision that I was going to be in a solo commercial. They're like, this kid got enough shit. Just put him in his own 30 second. So we get done with the day. 22 hour day, fam. I'm sore as fuck. It's the first time in the studio. My adrenaline's up. I'm meeting people that I grew up watching. I mean, Speedy. You know, I saw him from my favorite movie of all time when it's fired. Above the Rim.
Where is Vaughn?
Above the fucking Rim. I've been talking about that. That's something we want to talk about too. I'm trying to figure out a way how to remake that shit. So that's something we're going to talk about on the next segment, but that should be, I mean, I think that was one of the dopest close. There's a lot of good basketball films, but the inner city and the elements with drugs on court and off court, that shit clutch.
It's the same as hand to hand. It's sad, but.
And I worked with Dwayne Martin on the LA Finest, so we got a chance to talk about it, but we'll get up on that topic. Mm-hmm. But man, so we left. A month later, I'm driving to Ford Focus, right? I was working Burger King, and then I switched it to Athlete's Foot. So I got the Floor Focus. My phone rings. It's June. It's about, no, like late May, early June. Phone rings. I didn't answer. And I'm driving, right? And this is a Nokia shit where you can't really, you know, you can't see. You got to pick up the phone. I stopped. I think I went to Dairy Queen over there on Wood Avenue. I looked at fam, like, no lie, 40 missed calls. Future. Yo, Future's up. Lou, you ain't watched it. I was like, what you talking about? We got a commercial, man. This shit's out. It's fine. Yo, you got one by yourself. Man, I hung up the phone and ran home, sat there in front of the playoff game, and that shit aired during like the NBA finals, during the Sixers and every fucking timeout, that shit aired. From there, bro, phone kept ringing. Every sneaker company, everybody, like, and this was before I wanted to get into acting. Man, I was getting scripts and just saying no, because my passion was to play streetball. I went to BYU. I was dubbing shit, not knowing now that I'm like, fuck, I'm an idiot. I should have took those opportunities. But I was still 18 years old, living home. We lived in Angel Street.
The lady called me and she said, Main Event, thank you very much. He was just so much better than everyone else. You know, shout out to everybody that was involved. But he was like, she said, yo, he was just amazing. I said, yo, that's why I knew who to choose for this opportunity. And that's going to step me to what you're going to talk about now. You know, like, we had a lot of rap artists that went and became, got into, like, acting and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You might be one of the first street ballers that went to that next level. Yes, we had Hot Sauce that played in a movie.
Right.
I think Professor played in one. Sick with it played in something that just came out. But just seeing your transition,
yeah,
it's kind of like, I don't know if you noticed, but you also on the other side doing what I did for the culture for the street ball,
yeah,
where you're by transferring over, crossing over to the acting thing, and on the level you got to and going to go, it's like you give a person like me or Sauce or Shane or somebody on these new cats, I'm like, yo, I might be an actor one day, because for us it was more street basketball, NBVL, hopefully NBA.
Yeah, yeah.
I was never even thinking about, I'm going to get into acting.
And yo, fam,
you open up a door for that, you know? And I appreciate you doing that.
And here's this, what people don't really understand. Through all my films I've done, and I got to tell you, let's say one of the most popular, arguably, right? Fast and Furious. When I tell you how many basketball fans are on that set, from the director to Vin Diesel, when you play ball, you're glorified immediately. You know what I mean? Wow. Got a chance to play the Trotters a little bit, and, you know, the Wizards, but, you know, and show basketball, did some stuff with Nike, but man, the gratification you get as a hooper, let alone somebody like your stature who's got the name and the clout, right? Playing basketball, that's your resume. So I tell people, don't worry about the craft on, you know, trying to create, or I have to become the actor, and, you know, what method am I gonna go in creating this character. People overthink it, and I feel like this industry in acting, and I've been in it for 17 years now, they charge people to manipulate their mind to feel like you have to be believed in it has to be organic from here, but all you're doing is just reiterating what your own intuition has to know to begin with. So for instance, like, this is a little acting 101. If you're playing, obviously, the not the easiest roles to get into, but to meet some profile, right? African American, strong. They're not gonna pick you for no lead Brad Pitt. Me, I'll probably look Puerto Rican. I got the tattoos. They pick me for the rougher roles. But it's not what roles you're getting into. It's how do you capitalize and transition that to your very next one? And then how do you become the best at what you do in your own lane? Like I did with Nike. I'm not trying to be an All-American or Rafer Alston. I'll never be Skip. Skip, what do you mean? $69 million on Toronto? I would never. But can I be the best freestyler that ever existed? Or at least a pioneer like you did? And I said, let me stay in my lane and be the best. And I learned that from Coach Boy on St. Pat's. He said, all my team players, you ain't got to be the best, and not everybody here is going to be in the NBA. Your job to stay on the team, this is before I play for Coach Colicchio, is be the best at what you can do. If you take charges, motherfucker, take the most charges. And I said, you know what?
That's right.
Shit, I'm fast. I can dribble. Let me just be the fucking best I can do. I don't give a fuck with things I can't shoot or whatever. But if I can get past you, at least pass it to somebody like you who ain't gonna miss, nigga, I'm winning. You gonna keep me on the team?
No doubt.
Real shit.
No doubt.
Not everybody's there. Not everybody's designed to be a Brad Pitt. Not everybody's gonna be a LeBron. But you can make a career being the 6th, 7th, 8th motherfucking 12th man on the bench. Understand like they're lame, like you're always the star, but you need people around you to understand that, because if not, it becomes a conflict, right?
Mm.
So you everybody has to stay lame. Yeah. So like for you, like to get into acting with anybody I tell, like we had this conversation before, bro, it's never too late. It's all about, and I tell people like this, if you did what you did with streetball, with no social media, fam, sky's the limit. Sky's the limit, because if they don't know you, they heard of you. That's your resume alone. You never got the guy. Somebody's going to give you a shot. You just got to be persistent, diligent, you know? And you get that opportunity, you keep rolling into something else. And you're done acting. You don't even know you've done it, but you did it. All them commercials, that's Screen Actors Guild all day long. That's a resume. You just got to think about it, put it together. I'm like, fuck, I really got a resume. Don't even know it. So when I signed my Screen Actors Guild, I think I was on my third project. I think I did Law & Order. After that, my first movie was The Brave One with Jodie Foster and Terrence Howard. How I got that? Neil Jordan, the director, saw me in a halftime show at the Knicks doing the dribbling. Oh, I like this guy. He's from Ireland. You should come to the audition. I think we like you. I had this beehive spinning haircut. I went to probably like 15 auditions throughout that summer, 2006. I was reading for one of the backup roles, and he said, you know what? You never acted before in a big movie, but we like your energy. So I wanted to read for like another character that was Raphael, and Lee was the main character. They end up giving me the main character. I worked with Jodie Foster, Joel Silverman, Robert Downey Jr., Suzanne Downey was the producer. So it was star-studded. The movie did number one at the box office that following September. my first movie.
Wow.
What that did was, okay, made a couple dollars. It was scale. I wasn't getting nothing off the book. I was getting scale. I don't know what the scale was at the time. It was still decent money, but it was union work. I worked a lot of weeks. But more importantly, you come off a project that you just thought that this was going to be a one and done. Now you have a little resume. So now you have the opportunity for that same casting director you read for to read again. And then she's going to refer you to somebody else. And again, man, you keep your head down, keep going, it's going to happen. Like, I look back now, 15 years ago, I'm like, man, this shit is not like the basketball. Because it was a struggle, man. For every movie I booked, I got turned down for like 30. I still got bills to pay. I have a car. You know, I have a Porsche. Like, you know, we're young. You see money for the first time. I was going to Julian's, buying everything up, doing dumb shit, right? But you're young. So, you know, you're saying to yourself, like, I didn't get the credibility like I did when I was with Nike. Being that I was with Nike for like 12 years, traveling the world. You know, they didn't care in the acting. I had to sit in an iron fold-out chair and audition like everybody. But I said, shit, I'm not going to be in the NBA. What is my next chapter? This is considered entertainment. You know, when I get stopped to somebody, yo, Trix, do a couple moves for me. I'm like, yo, I'm low-key an entertainer. I was like, let me own that shit.
Let me own it.
Yeah, the handles on ice, all the time. But at the end of the day, there was still shame they went through for that. So Pat the Rock, I inspired. Then he got great. They had Pat even coming up doing that. This is even before Hot Sauce was even doing it. Because pretty much you had Hot Sauce and Nike was thankful to have me. So it was me and Hot Sauce. Great kid. Yeah. Philip is fucking super talented. But like, you had that lane. But one thing is, and I look back and I'm like, man, only if I signed with N1, what could have been? It's like, sometimes you look back now, you're like, can you imagine that one kid before Professor that did Trix shit? Like, I'm thinking, I'm like, wow, this shit could have been crazy. But, you know, our era, and you know, it's a lot of like narrative where people saying, well, you know, a lot of the street ballers, they didn't know how to handle business, they fell apart, they split up. Yeah, but I don't think our culture was so new and we didn't know how to monetize it that it wasn't organized.
Mm-hmm. So I tell people, I didn't have a blueprint, you know. Everything was just going off of like, yo, we, at the end of the day, we getting paid to do something that we love to do. So it really wasn't ever work for us.
And if I had to do it again, I would be like, man, you should be like the lead of the players union. Maybe hire one good attorney. And the first thing we should have did, what I think about now, and I still feel firm about it. Why is this shit not a fucking X Games? Why not? Why can't we have a street ball 3-on-3 tournament on X Games? They're talking about bringing it to the Olympics.
We're going
to
talk about that. Oh, we're going to talk about that off the air, but I got something for you to let you know about what you're saying with that. Definitely something real interesting, but I'm going to let you know right now, you know, you made the right choice. Well, put it like this. The creator used you in a different way. And...
Well, I personally came to you. I came to you and asked you.
No, I'm talking about far as with the N1 thing. Like,
I asked you. You said, Lou, go with Nike. We had that conversation.
Yes, because I already seen how things was going. There's no way that I could pull you in knowing that things is not as good as it look. That's why I said, yo, keep doing that. I know the creator got something totally different. And I don't think you would have got, I don't think you would have had that opportunity through N1, because what I told them, it was supposed to be a stepping stone to go play ball.
Right.
That acting thing was just the blessing from the creator. So you know what? No, I'm going to use Trix in a different way. Rather it was me to say, no, Trix, no, stay over there.
Yeah.
I know at the time, I remember that conversation because you was like, that's kind of weird though. You know
what
I
mean? Like, man, I did this shit.
I want to rock with you.
Right.
And I'm telling you, no, bruh, go do that right there.
Right.
Not knowing what was going to happen years later, you know, but I just knew that, you know, and happy that you was able to create your own lane and the creator just blessing you to give other cats hope, rather than any other streetball player may not never get into acting at all. But you as a cat who cats can sit back and say, wow, that's why I wanted to show that clip.
Yeah.
Got the world record in the World Guinness Record Book. It was a part of one of the most amazing Nike commercials. And then it goes to all this. I remember the first time my son came down, he was like, yo, Quentin. He said, yo, Pops, yo, Trix in the movie. And I was like, what movie? He said, Fast and Furious. Yo, I ain't gonna front. I started watching that joint. Next thing I know, this, power. I said, well, he out of here now. Because, you know, it's just like in your cat, like, you, it's like whatever you touch, I know that you're gonna be successful because of the hard work and the dedication and the energy that you put behind it. You don't let it work you work it. And I don't care if they say Trix do whatever, I know it's gonna be successful.
Well, you know what, and I appreciate that, man, but you gotta think, coming where we from, what's the worst that I can hear? I mean, I heard, oh, I just dribbled too much. I heard it all. So for me, it was just like, what's a no? You know what I'm saying? If you can take a no from your mom, you can take a no from your girlfriend. If somebody says no, it don't matter. But this industry is meant for, you go to audition, prime example, I'm gonna keep this shit clean. I just auditioned a couple weeks ago for a project that Kevin Hart and a personal friend of mine, John Travolta, is doing. Lee, John Travolta calls me, we talk.
With your daughter.
Right, so we do a lot of work, and I didn't tell him I was reading for it. I read for it, killed the audition, I send it just a regular way, I told him about it. The role was, could they change it for me to be the lead in it? Yes, but they didn't. But guess what? It don't matter. Like, if you're good, you're good, you're in it, but you're not gonna get every opportunity. And I look at it like the same way in the league. You're All-American, right? Great ball player. Mm-hmm. But if the coach wants to pull you out for those 2 minutes, you can't be but that man. He got his own vision. If you wasn't good, you wouldn't make the squad. So, but to some people be like, man, I didn't get that role. I felt like I did. And you just can't put your head down. You just can't be, because, you know, once you get into an audition, you audition and you feel like you don't get the role, you got to think, we're not getting paid unless we're actually booking. But to book it, you audition 3 times, you meet a director or producer. It's a process. It's a process. So, and it's a while to get it. And then, so I tell people, the work is free. What we're getting paid for is the auditioning, the grind, the reading to try to help, because you're going up against a lot of people. And now look, now with social media, we didn't have this opportunity where we could FaceTime on live. So now what would happen? If you needed an audition, you had to go to the office. So if you weren't in Chicago, LA, or New York, you want to be an actor, you have to fly there. Now you can be in West Bubble, fuck Egypt, or some obscure town in Tennessee, put yourself on tape and get casted. So I tell actors now, bro, sky's the limit. You just gotta have the resources. How do you get into acting? People, I get this million questions, and I'm gonna give it to you right now. You put a little resume together, and if you don't have one, that's fine. You got skits you're doing, create it. If not, that's cool too. Go to background actor, backstage, where you get the background roles, and they pay you just for there. Once you're there, you network. You meet different people. Right. You learn how the business goes. Once you're in one, you're gonna be in another one. Even if it's a couple hundred hours, but you're there for 12 hours, you gotta put the time in. That's how anybody got in. There's no secret. Yeah. But some people was like, I'm sitting there 12 hours eating this bullshit ass lunch for $200. Man, fuck that, I ain't gonna do it. But you have to do something to get in if you don't have a resume. So you have to compensate something.
That's right. And you can't, like you said, you can't give up, because you may go there reading one part and they may say, well, you didn't get picked for this, but it may be someone there who may be doing a project for something else and said, yo, I know I can use them for this. And like you said, it's all networking, man. Closed mouth don't get fed.
No, absolutely. And you know, and you listen, I'm gonna keep it a buck though. You know, times are not easy. Things are not expensive. Cost of living's a lot, especially, you know, whether you're in LA or New Jersey or New York, it's expensive. So people, you're chasing, you know, most people check by check to try to raise your family. You got kids, you got school, you got education, you got insurance. I get it. But if you have a passion for something, you have to invest in yourself. So it's almost like a business. Like, man, I got to get a job. You know what? I'm going to do a little bagel shop. How much is it going to cost me? Maybe $10,000-$15,000 to start. Maybe I get a loan. Well, if you really want to be an actor, take that same fucking loan. That 10-15 months can buy you a year or two. So you go balls to the wall, auditioning and auditioning. And even if you don't get it, every casting director knows your name. Sure enough, that shit gonna pay off, bro.
Yo, you know, it's crazy you say that. Because when you hear these stories where people say, yo, I took my last check and I went out to California and blah, it's right what you're saying. It's just taking that chance and believing in yourself. Starting with yourself. Believing in yourself and not giving up. You know what I mean?
After, so this is what I did to get started. So I looked at, and this is for any other up-and-coming actor who wanted, I used the resources I had. This is how easy it was for me. I had Nike, but now Nike, I was on like a 12-year contract with Nike, but one of the dopest commercials that I posted on my Instagram was shelved in 02 because of some kid named LeBron James. Who the fuck is this kid? I'm the Nike kid. Like, this commercial's it. And now I get why they fucking shelved it, because they had a vision.
Was it the one with the Indian people or something?
Motion Lab. It's like me with, like, I turn into a character. I posted on my feed. It's like,
I saw that. I saw something on here too. I think it was with like some Indian people. What was that commercial or something? You remember doing something like that?
Indian people.
I had like long jackets on. I'll find it. I saw it earlier today, but I was looking through some stuff.
Right, but like there's so much they had in the shelves, but once they did the LeBron campaign, they kind of shelved it. But I'm like, okay, it's kind of the end of that. And then I saw what happened with A1. It turned into Ball Up. And you guys had a successful run, but you guys were already trying to plan out. Once I started seeing people branch out doing their own thing, I said, okay, there's got to be more to the story. Plus, I was getting inside from Mark Edwards at the time. You know, he was with Professor, and that's Raphael's cousin. I just found out that later on in life.
Sauce manager.
Shout out to Mark, but he's a nut. That's a whole other conversation.
We cool now though.
I know where it could go with it, but we cool.
Salute Mark. You learned it was a grooming process. You know, you learn that what I eat can't make you shit. Yeah. So at the end of the day, we just respect each other. It just takes some time. And I salute Mark that much, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I get it. But you know, after the whole ball up thing, I was saying to myself, so what do I do? So I Googled top markets where you could be a working actor. And at that time, it was during TRIXX tax incentives. So I guess states were offering more for production companies. New Orleans. Man, I picked up my car. I think I rented at the time. I was living in Florida with some girl at the time. This is after like 2007, 2008. And drove a smart car when it first came out because it was cheap on fuel. You know, I really wasn't working. The residuals from Nike was slowing down. So I'm like, man, this is, what the fuck am I going to do? I rented a car and drove overnight, 15 hours from Miami to New Orleans, slept. So this is during Mardi Gras weekend. I couldn't afford a hotel. It's $400, $500, $600 a night, Mardi Gras. But it was an audition for the first one, and they gave me the opportunity just to come and read. I said, man, if I don't do this, I'll never get a chance to. Oh, but I had no agent. It was fantastical. Man, I slept in a smart car. Now, let me tell you something. I know it sounds bad. You 6'4". I'm 5'11 and a half, 60, whatever. That smart car, man, you get some motherfucking leg room in that bitch, bro. You put the legs up in the dash, man, you all right. But now I try to make the best of it. I slept in the car, got no sleep, probably like 2-3 hours. And then the audition was early in the morning. 16 pages I had to memorize. I'm sitting there, one of my first ones. I'm shaking. You know, because I'm like, I didn't get no sleep. I'm so stressed on getting there that I didn't enjoy the process of the audition because I'm like, now I need it because the drive. So I'm sitting here, I'm shaking. It was for American Heist. I never forget with Akon and Hayden Christensen and a couple other actors. But I drove back to Miami, called my parents. I'm sitting there like bawling, bro, like emotional. Like, what do I do? Like, should I just go get a job? I'm smart. Like, what the fuck? And then 2 days later, they called me for a call back again. And then they were like, well, you don't have to come. We like your look for it. It's fine to take it. But this is it. Were there better actors? Maybe. But this is where I think I capitalized. I took that 15-hour drive to a state like Louisiana and New Orleans where they didn't have a lot of talent. So now they were like, do we fly one in and pay the LA price or just take this kid here because he said he's local for hire? I did a fucking hustle. So I booked it. I forced them to book me. And then they loved me. But that's sometimes what you have to force that hand. You have to finesse.
So you thought you were from there.
Huh?
They thought you was from New Orleans. Now, I know that you go. Yeah, no doubt, yo.
I'll pay local for hire. Yeah. I'll sleep in the car and shower at Planet Fitness if I have to.
Word, that's smart. That's dope. That's, yeah.
You have to. And then there, the casting director's like, oh, you're from New Orleans? Yeah. So my boy, Jason Mitchell, from Straight Outta Compton, who played Eazy-E.
Yeah.
My brother, yo, Jason Mitchell. He let me stay at his grandfather's house. Now, this is before Jason was in Eazy-E and on that NWA, he did Straight Outta Compton. He did the motherfucking King Kong. He did mad shit now. He's with UTA. He's blown up. And before that, you know, he's like everybody else. They, you know, he's in the streets, he's hustling. He's got guns on the shelf. Everything's cool. I'm in Holly Grove, sleeping in his grandfather's crib, using his address as local for hire. Nigga, after that, 21 Jump Street. All these movies I was doing, I should... Mr. Wright, that's on Netflix right now. 7 of my movies I shot in New Orleans is on Netflix right now because it was Hollywood moving to a state where it's cheaper to film. So I tell people and your viewers right now, you want to act? You're in New York? Dub it if you're not in theater. New York's big theater. Go to Atlanta. It's fucking huge. If you're African-American and you want to act especially... Atlanta is your kingdom because Tyler Perry has that shit like this, bro. It's all black-based comedy, comedy romance or action films, but they want African-American actors. And if you got the New York swag and the New York state of voice, they don't have that down south, you're gonna book like, you're gonna be booking like a librarian. Seriously. Atlanta, New Orleans slowed down. LA's a hit or miss because everything out of LA, even when I was living in LA, we shoot somewhere else anyway. And let's go on a studio.
And most of the shit that I'm doing films. I'm not on a regular series in the studios that's filming in LA currently. So I was living in LA, still filming in New Orleans, still filming in Boston and other places. I'm like, I'm never even in LA.
Wow.
So, you know, so then 2016 came along and I had my beautiful daughter, my first girl, Zoe, and she's in New Jersey, so it kind of keeps me more on the East Coast. But now I'm to the point where it's just like I'm getting into producing. I'm trying to help people that are trying to look for the blueprint, because people that want to get into acting, though, man, like, they think it's really harder than it is. But you just don't have the right steps, because it's not easy. It's not an easy industry. It's not. It's worse than music. Like 50 Cent even told me himself, it's harder than music, but you make more money. But you got to be smart about it. How do you monetize it? Even if you're doing small roles, you can capitalize being that nigga on that. We need a bad guy, we're going for him.
No doubt.
He's available. He's going to be there on time. He's going to get the job done. He don't have back union due pays. Little shit like that plays a part. You know what I'm saying? Plays a part. And plus, man, for somebody like yourself or anybody who's a basketball enthusiast, if you just remotely have, you know, barbershop talk and say you play basketball, you talk basketball, find out the director likes the sport, you finesse it. Bro, listen, everybody's human. If you're a cool dude, they're going to rock with you. If you're a dickhead, you're going to find yourself missing out.
No doubt.
That's a fact.
That's super dope, man. Hey, it's, like I said, we don't know how things come about.
You got the goatee. You out here handsome looking like Tank.
I had to get a little fresh up for the, you know, for the quarantine.
You out here looking like Tank. You ain't age either, bro. You look good.
Hey, man, this God bless. I live to see 46 in February, but I don't forget, my cousin called me. He was in,
Hold on, when's your birthday?
It was February 27th.
My daughter's the 16th. I don't know if that's the same sign, but happy belated.
No, same to him, man. So my cousin called me. He was like, I think I was in Philly or somewhere by Philly. What's that by Philly? What did he go live at? What's that? It's in Jersey, but it's by Philly.
Cherry Hill.
Was you in Cherry Hill? You saw my cousin at a restaurant or something?
Yeah, I was talking.
Yeah, and he was like, yo, I'm Linda and something like that. He said, you might know. He said, what? And then he called me.
I'm going to tell you what it was. I met him Labor Day weekend in Cherry Hill at Bahama Breeze.
There you go. Yep. Bahama Breeze. Yo, it's crazy. Yo, he tested positive for the corona, but he's doing okay now.
Oh, he is.
He quarantined himself. You know, he's doing okay.
I'm going to tell you like this, man. I got a 5-year-old, so I just don't know how to, like, and my parents, like, nobody in our lifetime, or grandparents lived through. This is worse than like people living through the World War. Like, we've never been in a global pandemic at this extent. So it's like, how do you adapt? It's almost like so surreal, like a bad dream. But we're saying to ourselves, shit, if this is going to be the new regular, how do we monetize this? So now what I'm thinking is social distancing, an app. Maybe we could do a dribbling app teaching kids how to do shit in the crib. Like, you have to think outside the box. I'm also a published children's book author, so I'm taking time to write. But like, what do we do to give back? So, you know, on that note, before we end that segment later on, I got a couple pieces here I'm going to donate to you to give out, like, to raffle from your page. I got a movie coming out, Red Winter, that I shot in Colorado with Vernon Davis, two-time Pro Bowler, 16 years in the league, played for San Francisco, played for the Redskins, and won the Super Bowl 50. With the Denver Broncos, and I was out there, but I got a football signed by him, and it's in a glass case, so we can donate that. It'd be nice to kind of raffle it off, you know, put some smiles on people's faces during this time, if they're Vernon Davis or football fans, 49er fans or Bronco fans, we'll auction that off. And then I also got from Damon Lillard, gave me his a pair of his new. His new Dame 6 from All Star Weekend, so we'll send that off, and you have a platform, so I'll make sure you get that, and we'll figure out a way where we can do a raffle and kind of our version of our All In Challenge, just to give to somebody who probably is a fan or something like that. So that'll be dope.
No, I appreciate that, man.
But you know, in terms of this whole industry, man, it's just about trying to give back, and I see big things for us. I mean, I was honored 2 weeks ago. This is I think the day. They kind of, the 2 days before they shut down New Jersey with our governor, I was, inducted in Lyndon for the proclamation. That was dope. And I shot you out on that. But if it wasn't for you,
listen, 54 for sure.
To be 37 years old and inducted in your town, and thanks to you, like it's amazing how somebody like yourself, and kudos to you. People don't know, but you know, you ran for councilman, and I tell you like this: I think you should continue all those efforts, and I really see in the near future you being a mayor of the city. I mean, this is your city, hands down, and look what you've done for me, and I inspired the world. But guess what? If somebody put somebody on, Drake is Drake because of Lil Wayne, and Lil Wayne's Lil Wayne because somebody. And if it wasn't for you, this wouldn't even be in existence. So how do we build on that? And I think, you know, a private auction, maybe doing a weekend for the community, because we need to kind of embrace this of some sort. Because, you know, times like this, man, we're so used to coming together, but for the first time, we're actually splitting apart, and it's hard to put a smile on people's faces. I know it's hard for my mom especially, because she got grandchildren now. She can't see them. So the FaceTime, she's sitting there crying. It's just difficult. It's a difficult time, but we have to know at least we're breathing, because, man, as you know, I've been to enough countries like you, and people have been living rougher than this for a long time.
For real, man.
I could come back and be happy and be like, man, yo, people, I remember walking Taiwan alleys and people almost selling off their daughters for money to feed their family. And I'm giving off my little per diem to try to feed. And that's the wrong thing to do, because they tell you no, because if you pay one, they jump you. And it's just like, you know, it's heart wrenching. I get chills now, but we take a lot for granted. And, you know, it's what we can do for our community. But you got to understand how powerful you were to the community and how you are, because you inspired many more than I think you probably honestly take credit for.
Nah, I definitely appreciate that, man. And, you know, me and you could go on for days, but I just happy that, you know, you took the invite. I know you got a lot of things going on, and I just want to say continue your success.
Yeah, absolutely, bro.
We're praying for you and your family.
Stay here, bro. And let's catch up after this clear up, we'll talk, but you got my number. Make sure you hit me up, and then I'll post a picture and send it to you so you can post it on some of the things we can auction off on whoever was live on your viewers, and then we'll do it from whoever was live on your feed, and we'll do like a couple of things like giveaways and shit like that.
Okay.
Bless.
Yo, salute. Thank you, Trey.
Love you, boy.
Blessings, man. Love you, bro.
All right, man.
Peace.
Today's episode of Convo with Maine is sponsored by
operator or a small to medium sized trucking company. Well, Loads of Us is here for you. With our database of shippers and brokers, no matter what type of trailer you have, we can keep you moving. We can get you more money per mile and lower your deadhead. With our logistics team, we can take care of setup packages, invoicing, and all other paperwork pertaining to your loads. With our customer service team, we can stop the aggravation of 100 calls so you can concentrate on doing the load properly.
Are you unloaded?
With our team of agents working for you, not only will it make you look like a big trucking company, you will be able to get more done with less aggravation. Our model is, if you want to make money and stay on the road, let Loads R Us book your loads. Loads R Us, the load finder and dispatch service.
Thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed. Make sure you hit that subscribe button, hit that notification bell. Every Sunday, same time, same place, different combo.
Check. We go hard or go home, it's all out. You think you got some game, you getting balled out. This a one-on-one, so clear the floor out. All eyes on you, it's time to ball out. Your palms sweating, your heart beating like double dribble. You gotta stay in the zone to drop a double triple. Triple double, I cross over and flip the hustle. Don't step in my lane unless you got the muscle. I'm elbowing, shot blocking and ball snatching. No blood, no foul, homie, you straight hacking. A lot of fake players came and went. Get your popcorn, it's time for the main event. Yeah.